the market is now starting to respond in a pretty fundamental way. And in addition to that, there's a kind of popular reckoning with climate change as an existential issue, particularly among the young, particularly among Generation Z, that I think we would not have been able to label as so significant just, say, 2 years ago. And then into all of that, you have a presidential election in the United States. So the discussion of climate change is absolutely at the fore, and that's the context in which the United Nations is meeting. Right. And the UN has said kind of wonderful things about its aspirations to do something about climate change before. I think it's probably fair to say that there have not been many times in the past when the world is itself as intent on seeing something done as is the case now.
That's interesting, because obviously, given the backdrop, given all that's going on right now in the world, we did see that UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres said that diplomacy, to be effective, requires personal contact. What are some ways, some of the progress that they're trying to make in resolving some of these issues? How is that going to be impacted when you aren't able to have these face-to-face discussions that do have a lot of nuance?
Well, I guess I'd say two things. First of all, there's not a lot of evidence, I don't think, that personal contact at the United Nations level has done much in the past, to be blunt. There have been United Nations meetings about climate change for years now, just like there have been meetings in the halls of Congress in the United States and in capitals all around the world, in which politicians have intoned in very deep voices that they are very concerned about climate change and that the time to do something is now. And we as a world haven't done much. So it seems to me that perhaps more important than personal interaction in the halls of the United Nations is a sense on the part of the people, the politicians, the diplomats who will be meeting at the United Nations, that they're gonna have to answer to important constituencies back home if they come out of that building not having done something significant. And regardless of the fact that they're having to meet virtually rather than in person, it's absolutely the case, I think, that none of them is confident that things are going to be okay for them politically if they dither on this one this time.
And as you mentioned, when you think about politics and constituents, then you also look on the private sector side, talking about some of these companies that have been lining up to make this a priority. How do you see public versus private roles in really making some advancements on some of these catastrophes that we're seeing?
Well, I think that the narrative generally has been assumed to be that the public sector has to lead so that the private sector feels compelled to follow. That is, governments have to do big things, make important restrictions so that companies will respond. And there is plenty of evidence in environmental history for that phenomenon happening. But there's not a lot of evidence that government has done significant stuff about climate change, really, in most parts of the world. And so what's happening now is quite interesting. What's happening now is actually that businesses, and including Fortune 500 businesses, some of the largest corporations in the world, are looking around the world, looking at what's happening in terms of the sentiment of their customer base, looking at what's happening in terms of their investor base, the kinds of demands that they're being hit with at their shareholder meetings, and they're deciding that it behooves them to act more aggressively and earlier than politicians are forcing them to act. And so what you actually have now is the phenomenon where the private sector is moving more aggressively than the public sector is. And I think it's fair to say that it is the public sector leaders, the kinds of people who will be meeting under the auspices of the United Nations, who are the ones feeling the heat.
Now, I do want to look at the latest NOAA report on climate change. Talk about the economic toll of some of these extreme weather and climate events that we're seeing more of.
Well, I mean, to talk about the economic toll of these events is kind of like peeling an onion. I mean, the direct costs of these events, and we can talk just about the wildfires in California, as I say, where I am right now, the direct costs are massive. That is to say, the costs to the people who have lost their houses, to say nothing of the people who have lost loved ones who will not be earning income in the future, to say nothing of the emotional cost, of course, of all of this. But just in terms of economic costs, they're the direct costs. But then there are all sorts of indirect costs. The infrastructure that has been destroyed by these fires is going to have to be rebuilt. And it is taxpayers who will pay for that rebuilding. the there will be insurance policies that will bail out the people who have lost property in these fires, and insurance companies are going to have to make that money up somewhere, and that potentially leads to higher insurance rates for you and me and lots of other people. And then ultimately, if the world, if the kinds of people who are meeting at the United Nations deal with climate change significantly, there are going to have to be even more fundamental questions about how we build, where we build, that are going to have to be dealt with, that will have economic ramifications.